Now Laura will lead a panel who can offer guidance on what venture capital investors are looking for in a startup and the entrepreneurs that run them. Laura will be joined by Gené, Aileen Lee, founder and managing partner at Cowboy Ventures, Brian Dixon, a partner at Kapor Capital, and Natalia Oberti Noguera, founder and CEO of Pipeline Angels.
Thank you so much. Okay. So we are super excited to thank you. To be able to have this panel to let you hear from VCs. This is an honor for me. How often do I get to grill the VCs? So this doesn't happen very much. But Aileen, Brian, Natalia, Gené, really appreciate you being here. So I actually wanted to start with a question that follows up from what Gené was saying. I was really fascinated by the data that shows that, you know, there's some percent of seed funding that goes to women. Some percent of seed rounds go to women, but the funding amount, the percentage is actually lower than the number of rounds. And so what does this mean? Does this mean that women actually end up getting less money? Is it more that what they're starting deserves less money? I'd love some perspectives on that.
Well, I'll start off. I think the simple answer is no, their startups don't deserve less money. And I think that's... Yeah, so that's one. And I think that's kind of part of the problem, right? Of when you look at funding, it's like oxygen for a startup.
It is.
And it gives you more time to go out and do the awesome things that you're trying to do. And what happens when you have less funding, and you see this also with founders of color, is that you're competing against companies that might have a 12-month runway when you've got six.
Yeah.
And that's just unfair. And it's one of the reasons why we're trying to do what we do at Kapor Capital in one piece of solving the problem.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Natalia?
As a cis LGBTQ Latina, my gender pronouns are she, her. I also think about it in terms of the different intersectionalities. So it's not just women. According to the Project Diane report, for the past several years, 0.2% of venture capital funding has been going to Black women founders. Not 2%, 0.2%. And so.
And that's a catastrophe.
And so. Similarly, you know, at Pipeline Angels, what we do is that we serve as the friends and family round for entrepreneurs who might not have the friends or family to provide that critical early capital injection. And of our 40-plus portfolio companies, over 20% now have a Black woman founder.
And actually, let me stop there. How many of you are familiar with the phrases like friends and family versus seed versus Series A? How many of you don't know what those mean? Anybody? Way to go, overcoming your imposter syndrome.
Yes. Okay.
Let's talk a little bit about that.
Sure. So many people, if you have an idea and you're trying to prove it out, you need to do some research. You might need to hire somebody to do some part-time development. You might need a designer to do some wireframing. Oftentimes, people will raise a friends and family round, which could be $50,000. It could be $100,000, just to kind of get off the ground. And then, oftentimes, once you've demonstrated something, that there's a there, that customers want to use the product, you've talked to some customers, you've built an economic model, you've got a prototype or some wireframes, and you can basically tell the story of how you are planning on building a company and a business, then you often will go to seed investors or angel investors. To basically, we at Cowboy Ventures usually participate in rounds that are anywhere from $1 million to $3 million. Kapor is probably similar. And we are institutional seed investors where we get professional money and we're kind of considered professional investors, but there's also lots of individual high net worth individuals who write angel checks as well. And so oftentimes there's now an institutional seed round, which might be $1 to $3 million. And then after that, you know, most technology companies don't get profitable on that. Most technology companies then go raise what's called a Series A, where you would go to a more traditional VC firm. That's where I used to work, at a firm called Kleiner Perkins. There are many names and partners that you'll probably hear from venture firms while you're here at Grace Hopper that will invest and lead in your Series A, which often is anywhere from, let's say, $4 million to $10 million. And then people still don't get profitable on that. So then they raise a B and then a C. I actually have worked with a company that is on Series H. So, and so that's kind of what Laura's talking about in terms of friends and family versus seed and other rounds.
And there's a pitch for each of those rounds. And so let's talk about what mistakes people have seen when you've seen people pitch. And it could be different at different rounds. Natalia?
Yeah, well, I actually launched a podcast called Pitch Makeover, and it's on startups pitching, investing in more voices. And the way that we define more voices is women, non-binary people, and men of color. And it's literally a pitch makeover. We tell them what to keep, what to delete, and what to add. And what's exciting is that they get to do a do-over, because oftentimes, and I'm sure you've been there, we go to events or wherever, we give feedback to the entrepreneurs, and then they leave. So we don't really actually see what happens when they integrate the feedback. And I'd say one of my pet peeves, I have so many, where to start. I'd say when it comes to women and non-binary femmes, so anyone identifying with womanhood, cis, trans, third gender, I often notice that when it comes to the team section, there are a lot of what I call sole, like one person founders. And so oftentimes these one-person founders are out there trying to get funding, and a way to de-risk the investment is actually by your creating a team and showcasing that you have different sorts of skill sets and strengths in your team, so that the potential investor can see that once they invest in you, you have a team already in place that can scale and get you to where you need to be. So if you're already thinking about pitching and you still haven't figured out who that team is, or maybe you have informal advisors or team members, make sure to like formalize it and make sure to include that on your team page.
Yeah, Aileen, what have you seen?
Oh gosh, yeah, I've been doing this for a long time, so I've seen a lot of pitches. I think kind of to your earlier point and Janae's point about women raising less, I have heard this anecdotally, I haven't seen the data, it's hard to quantify this, but I have heard from some investors that women tend to pitch smaller. That a man, and again, I don't blame women for doing this in a way, because women, I do think, have to basically thread a much finer needle than men do. That's just something that we have to be prepared for, right? You can't be, like, you can't oversell, but you can't undersell. You can't, you know, you don't want to be too much of a dreamer, but you don't want to be too practical. Like, it is a kind of like a tighter needle, but it's completely surmountable, right? But I do think practice helps, doing research helps. There's plenty of online examples of slide decks that people pitch for their seed, for their Series A, for their Series B, that you can learn from. And there's plenty of people here and in entrepreneurial communities all around the world where you can practice and get feedback from people who have pitched before. But I do think, you know, storytelling is more important than ever. There's a lot of money, there's a lot of seed stage and Series A and Series B startups that are all competing basically for the same dollars and the same quality investors that are gonna hopefully help you de-risk your company. And so knowing how you're gonna tell your story and how you build momentum in terms of what's the big vision, how is an investor gonna get in on the ground floor of something that's gonna be really big and transformational? It's the next VMware. It's not a widget, it's something that actually has scale potential. And then talking about the team, talking about what you've built, talking about how customers want it and what the pain point is that you're solving, what the economic model is going to be. There's a kind of linear story that you want to tell, and surprisingly, actually, many people do get kind of caught sometimes not doing a great job telling the story and getting investors excited up front.
Yeah. I think one other point to that, too, is there's certain things that you can do that's really easy you can do tomorrow. So I think one is making sure, or today, yeah, don't even wait till tomorrow, today. So one is just looking at competitors. So we'll see a lot of entrepreneurs pitch VC firms of, hey, you did a company like Talent Sonar, and we're doing the same thing. You know, VCs typically make one investment in that space, and they don't want to have competitors in the same portfolio. So that's kind of one thing. I think two is like stage. So we'll see companies that are just really early of like, hey, we haven't, you know, it's really a friend and family type of round. We're investing at the seed stage, that's not a good fit for us. If you're doing a Series B and beyond, that's also not a good fit for us as well. So you really want to look at where your company is and is it a match for the VC fund.
Yeah, that's really great advice. And then tell me a little bit about what you see as mistakes that people make post-funding, because you all are going to go get your next round in the next month, I'm sure. So let's talk about what you need to focus on after funding.
My big pet peeve is communication. You got to think about it from an investor standpoint. We're writing checks anywhere from 100K to 250K, and that's a lot of money. And we want to know what's going on. We want to get monthly updates. We want to know how can we be helpful. Because at the end of the day, your investors are here to serve you and to serve the company and to see better outcomes. So I would say communication is definitely on the top of the list, because sometimes you see, you know, you make an investment and 3 months will go by and you won't hear anything from the startup, which is a little bit crazy.
Yeah, and sometimes you get a call like, hey, so it turns out we only have 3 months of cash left. That's also
First time you should be communicating.
Yeah, exactly. I would also say, I think parallel path road mapping is really important. So generally, you know, let's say if you raise $2 million, having a plan and kind of a kickoff with your lead or anchor investors to say, here's the plan. I think that we want to make this money last us 2 years. Here's what we're going to try and accomplish in terms of product roadmap, customer acquisition, economic model, hiring, like these, and here are the things we're not going to figure out in the next 2 years, right? And because you cannot get everything done, like entrepreneurship and startups are generally all about having to make choices and just trying to make the smartest, like taking smart risks. You cannot get everything done, but what are the most important things to get done so that when you have to go out and raise more, you've gotten the right things done that are going to impress investors so you can raise your next round?
Good. Well, I'm curious. Raise your hand if you're either an entrepreneur or an aspiring entrepreneur. Okay, so it's not everyone. And the reason that I wanted to bring this up is because I actually don't think that the answer in terms of changing the world is that we should all become entrepreneurs. You know, some of you might actually love your jobs, or you still haven't come up with an idea. And so another way that you can be active and engaged and keep your finger on the pulse in terms of the startup ecosystem is by becoming an angel investor. And that's what we do at Pipeline Angels. And the reason I'm bringing this up, because when I'm thinking about the post-investment relationship, you know, it's not just what the entrepreneurs you should be doing, especially any of you who are aspiring investors, whether, you know, becoming venture capitalist or becoming angel investors, something that you could be thinking about is how can you be useful when you're an angel. And one of my favorite definitions of angel investing is that it's smart money, meaning that it's not just the financial capital, it's the social capital and the human capital that you can provide. So social capital in terms of connections and networks that you can leverage for the entrepreneur, and then the human capital in terms of the skills and the expertise that you can provide. So there might be a startup that is in need of, you know, some in terms of the product roadmap, you know, like if someone can actually help them do that, then that's helpful for them as well.
I think that's great. And we all won't be entrepreneurs. That's the whole beauty of diversity, right? Some of us will be entrepreneurs. Some of us are going to be employee number three at a company, and that's fantastic. Some of us are going to be advisors to companies, especially if you are in, you know, kind of a big field or a big company. You may have some visibility into kind of what the market needs that your company is not going to be able to provide because your company is not agile enough. So become an advisor to some of these companies and help them see what your company sees in the market. So in just a couple of minutes, we're going to start taking questions. I think there's a microphone. I think it's over there, though I can't really see. And I think there's one over there. Questions can be for me about what I talked about before. Questions for Gené would be fantastic. So, oh, there's the microphone there. So if you have questions, please line up at the microphone, and that way we'll be able to hear everybody and what they have to say. So one last question before we get into what other people want to ask, because this is all about, to be honest, what you all want to learn about. So I'd rather, we're going to leave actually quite a bit of time for questions, so that would be great. How do VCs view women starting companies that are sort of women-centric versus not? You know, my companies have always been enterprise software companies, and yet there are women who start companies that are in the fashion industry or things that are sort of more usually looked at as kind of women-oriented fields. Is that a good thing, a bad thing? I'd love to understand the way you all would look at that.
Obviously, it's bad. Mic drop. You made me think about in 2012, one of our members, she participated in a startup weekend hackathon. And at the end of the weekend, you know, they do the demo day, they present the ideas, et cetera, and they presented to a panel of all guy judges. This was 2012, and the main feedback that they had was, like, your all-woman team was too distracting. And at the same time, you know, there are tons of, or, you know, there are tons of startups out there, I'll say, cough, cough, bustle, you know, that are aimed at women that get over $1 million in funding that just so happen to be, you know, like led by white guys. So obviously there is money for startups that are geared toward women and femmes, and yet look at who is, you know, running or spearheading those startups. So I'd say that one thing that I had such a great opportunity a couple weeks ago, I had the opportunity to interview Ellen Powell on her new book called Reset. And in the book, she's talking about how she's like in the middle of, you know, starting to sue Kleiner Perkins, and she is talking with a new CEO of Reddit called Yishan Wang. And even though she's like in the middle of this battle, she's encouraging him, saying, hey, you should actually consider taking money from Kleiner because you could really use it to scale and grow Reddit. And he's like, they're treating you terribly. Why would I want to get funding from, you know, someone who's treating you terribly? And so the one thing that I want to leave you all is that, and this is a privilege, I will acknowledge, that you might feel like you don't have a choice in terms of the funding because there's so few money like coming to women, non-binary people, or men of color. What I will say is that it still is a two-way street, and ask yourselves, who do you want to make money for? I'll say it again.
Absolutely.
Because it's super tweetable.
Yes.
So at Nakis Nakis, hashtag GHC17. Who do you want to make money for, right? So like I'd leave that with you.
Aileen, do you?
I totally agree. I think entrepreneurs right now have more power than ever in the ecosystem. I mean, you are the engines of growth. You're the engines of innovation. We heard earlier in the keynotes that this is the future of the industry of technology. So when you start companies, you do, hopefully you will have choices, and you'll be making money for the people who are on your, what you call your cap table, who has stock in your company. So you can basically choose who you're going to make money for. I think that's a really important consideration. I mean, look, many years ago, I wrote this blog post called Why Women Rule the Internet. Women spend all the money and are the drivers of social media. We are the users of the most important technology properties like Facebook. Women use Facebook more than men.
Yeah.
Women share more than men. Pinterest, House, even Zynga. Yeah. Like women basically, and if you look at, I'm fortunate I work with a company called Rent the Runway. There's, you know, Stitch Fix. There's incredible women-founded companies. Even Amazon is driven by, like the sales are driven by women. We just need the next founder to be a woman.
Exactly.
Because women are the users and the customers of all these products that have created incredible wealth and innovation in our society. So we need, I think, both women-focused ventures have huge potential, and women-founded ventures have huge potential.
Awesome. So let's go to questions. Can we start on this side, and we'll rotate back and forth?
I have two questions. The first is, do you have any recommendations for finding entrepreneur communities? And the second is, when you get to the I guess the funding phase, is it common not to just have like a prototype that isn't actually being used?
Yeah. So first question was where to find good entrepreneur communities.
Well, I serve on the board of Women 2.0, so I would encourage you to check them out. And I'm also on the board of Walker's Legacy that was named after Madame C.J. Walker, who just happens to be like the first self-made millionaire in the U.S. who happens to be a black woman. And we don't really know that story that much. So I say check out some of those places. And then I know that ABI does some startup events, so like even check out the ABI local events. And then I'd say social media is doing such a great job at really lowering the barrier to access and to entry. And so check out some hashtags, follow some of the speakers that you're meeting today and throughout the rest of the conference, and those are helpful places. In terms of the funding, you were asking, like, is it common to like go out for funding without a prototype? Was that your question?
Well, no, with a prototype, but I guess like I've always imagined venture funding as growing as opposed to just having an idea. that you're trying to get funding for?
Yeah, so the continuum that Aileen was talking about in the beginning, I'm a very visual person, so I'll do it like, this is the continuum. So generally we talk about bootstrapping, then friends and family round, then angel round, then venture capital round. So Nicole Sanchez, which actually I think used to be one of your colleagues, she's a hashtag Wise Latina, she talked about bootstrapping and how it's glamorized by the tech media, and that for a lot of our communities, it's simply called living, you know, like, which is a really great just reminder of how it's been positioned. And in terms of that, similarly to the friends and family round, like you have like white guys who are like, oh, I had a small friends and family round. It was like $500,000, right? And not everyone has that access. And so what I'd say is that we really need to be more transparent about how that prototype actually, there was like a cost to that, right? That people are not really talking about it. And so that's why, well, that's one of the reasons that I launched Pipeline Angels, because I was like, we need to create more capital at that stage to get these companies through the pipeline. Almost like, you know, I've been quoting Rihanna recently and saying, if we really want, you know, entrepreneurs of more voices to shine bright like a diamond, we need to invest in diamonds in the rough.
So Brian, when people come to you, do they have a prototype?
Yeah, so I would say out of the investments, we've got 130 portfolio companies, and they've all have prototypes. And I'll tell you the reason why is because, like Aileen mentioned, we're taking institutional money, and we've got to make a return on that money, and you're trying to reduce risk. And one of the ways to reduce risk is hopefully that there's some prototype and there's some traction.
Yeah.
So I think that's very important.
Even more than a prototype, people are using it.
Yeah.
Good. Let's go over here.
Hi. I have a question based on Janae's data that you showed us. So you alluded to women getting a certain percentage, or women founders getting a certain percentage of rounds and dollars. Mm-hmm. We've heard a couple of comments that allude to them being more successful than average. Can you talk a little bit more about that, maybe if there's any data to support that? And then maybe you talk a little bit about sort of why that might be. What are the traits and behaviors that the women founders show that make them more successful?
Okay. I think one of the studies that we haven't conducted but I'm interested in doing is looking at the outcomes for female-founded companies. So looking at the exits, and that's something that people have asked me over the last year. One of the challenges is obviously a lot of these companies are emergent, and so it takes 7 to 10 years to exit. So looking at successful outcomes is one way to look at the story. I did find that when you looked, I did a study a couple of months ago which looked at the amounts that female founders are raising, and it is true, it's less. I haven't got the numbers, that it was around 80%, you know, $80 for every $100 a male founder raises.
Wow, that sounds familiar to
the
big gap.
Right.
Yeah.
So it was around that. So in terms of successful outcome, I don't have good data on that today. But it's definitely something that we're going to be looking to do, looking at the exit side. I don't know if there's other ways.
There was a study that was, there's been a study that was done, and there was actually an article about it that was released yesterday. It's through NCWITS, that's part of University of Colorado, and it does say that women exits are, the returns tend to be better with women-founded companies. My hypothesis around that is we have imposter syndrome, so we do more research, and we understand better our markets before we come. A lot of men that I see pitching have a ton of bravado of, you know, I know my shit, and sorry, but, and we don't do that in a lot of cases. So that's just my hypothesis. Yeah. Over here.
Before I ask a question, I want to give you a context. I'm surrounded with male founders. Most of the times, my husband himself is a founder too. I run a nonprofit organization, and most of the ideas, business ideas that I get are to improve community, and which makes decent enough money, but not too much like other enterprise companies. So whenever I come up with this kind of ideas, all the advisors that I have will give me a feedback that, you know what, investors always look for X percentage of ROI, but the ideas that you have are great for the communities, but it doesn't make as much money as they expect. So my question is there really a space for companies or ideas that come up with things that can improve the community and also make a study
Yeah, that's a great question.
I'm like, yes, that's why I launched Pipeline Angels. So in 2008, I actually built a network of women social entrepreneurs in New York City from about six women to over 1,200 within 2 years. And that was really how I had my aha moment. And this was around the time that Tom's Shoes, Ben and Jerry's, Honest Tea were out there showcasing that the market actually wants and is interested in purchasing from companies that are doing well and doing good. The other thing, they were getting the funding, and guess what? They were led by white guys. Surprise. And so that's when I had my aha moment, because I realized that society has a gendered perspective on how we change the world. When a woman or femme says that they're going to change the world, the assumption is that they're going to launch a nonprofit. When a guy says that he's planning to change the world, people are not thinking that he's going to launch a nonprofit. And so that's the first part that we need to talk about, like the perception, right? Number two, I'd say the first thing that came to mind when you were sharing that story is Pipeline Angels member Kelly Hoey, and I think I saw her tweeting, so she might be around, so make sure to find her, often talks about how venture capital isn't a revenue strategy. So like, I'd love for all of you to just like, let's take a step back and talk about the word that you used was growing, right? Which is really important. At the same time, you need to think about what business model you have, and is it a business model that scales in a way that could be a good fit with angel or venture capital financing. There are also tons of business competitions and grants and stuff out there. And then I'd say the third thing is that the reason that they're saying that you need to have like an X type return is because they're putting an X type of investment in risk. And so one of the things that is really interesting in the impact investing ecosystem, and that's where we fit in, is that instead of thinking that you need to have like this huge home run to kind of like take care of the failures of all the other, basket of investments, it's like, well, what if you don't have like the huge home run, however you have like smaller exits, right? But in terms of the average, it might end up being the same. So like just something to keep in mind, and this goes back to the who do you want to make money for, and making sure that the investors that you're looking for match your mission and are interested in growing the way that you want to grow.
Awesome. Great question. Over here.
First of all, thank you so much. Natalia, the first time I heard of angel investing was from you back in 2013 at Barnard. And Aileen, this is my second time hearing you speak in 2 weeks, so I think I'm a group now.
Sorry. Is Karen?
Yeah.
Is that you?
Yay! my question is about entrepreneurs who come out of large companies. If you are an entrepreneur who comes out of a large company, what are the mistakes that you've seen those kinds of entrepreneurs make? And how can you best leverage your time at a large company to avoid those mistakes?
That's a fantastic question.
Yeah. I think large companies can teach you a lot of great things, best practices for product management, for a bunch of things, and also you can build a fantastic talent network that you can recruit from, hopefully, once you start your company. Some companies that come out of big platform, entrepreneurs that come out of big platform companies may underestimate the challenge of customer acquisition, because if you're Google, you don't have to basically figure out how to get customers. So in your pitch, if you're gonna start something, addressing that, saying, hey, coming out of Google, you may think that we're gonna be naive or maybe not think about customer acquisition. Let us show you what we've done or what we figured out. So you kind of head that off. And we've had great success backing people coming out of Amazon, Microsoft, Google, but they're generally folks who kind of demonstrate in their pitch and in the diligence their scrappiness, because that's something that you have to, that you, we are, investors can be a little wary about.
So I'd say make sure that you're nimble and agile and adaptable. The other thing is that you can showcase your expertise. Oftentimes, people are like, why are you the right person to be, leading the startup? And one of our new Pipeline Angels portfolio companies is called Sati. And what they do is it's a sanitary pad made out of completely compostable banana fiber. And guess what? One of the co-founders, Amrita Saigal, what was she doing before launching Sati? She was actually working at Always, at P&G at Always. So she actually knows what she's doing. She has that deep expertise that investors are looking for. And what did she major in at MIT? Manufacturing, right? So like in some ways, she was able to position herself in a way to showcase her thought leadership and that she knew the ecosystem because she came from the ecosystem and she realized that there was a pain in the market because she was actually coming from one of the key players in the ecosystem.
I think the point of this is think about what the investors are going to see your weakness as and be sure you address that in your pitch. So that's a great question. Unfortunately, this is going to be our last question. I'm sorry to everybody, but let's do our last question over here.
Hi, my name is Jocelyn. I'm an engineer in Facebook. My question is, what is the trait in women that you see can make us a better entrepreneur than male? Like when a woman pitcher come in, you say, hey, that's the trait I'm looking for. Do you have like that kind of woman?
Yeah, that's a great question.
And maybe from your personal experience, and how do we leverage that?
That's a great question.
Oh, well, one of the things that I've been saying is, and I was speaking at a tech inclusion conference a while back, and a woman of color who is looking to get more voices in the room, she talked about how her, you know, her organization is doing it, but making sure not to lower the bar. And I'm like, you know what, we need to reclaim the language and say getting more voices in the room is actually going to raise the bar. And the reason I'm bringing that up is because how many of you are tired of hearing that there's a pipeline issue? Whoa, hopefully by the end of this week, of these 3 days, everyone will be tired of hearing that it's a pipeline issue. What I've decided to do is like, you know what, it's a pipeline issue if we're talking about that the pipeline is clogged by mediocre white men.
I love that.
You know?
So yes, tweet that. Woo!
Yeah, I guess one other point to that. I think you should look at the investors' kind of backgrounds and traits. And a lot of funds go back to the data, right? Of like who's actually backing entrepreneurs and especially women entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs of color. And I think when we did the research, we saw one, we could do a way better job, and we have tried to improve. So we're up to 42% of our founders are women, and collectively with people of color,
was on the
of 56%. And I think it goes back to that, right, of like, you want a great founder who's gonna run through walls and do all the things that you can do, but that doesn't mean that you're gonna get the funding. And I think that's what we've gotta do for folks on the panel, of kind of change that narrative and actually invest capital into women, period.
I think that's great.
Yep.
Awesome. So thank you, everyone, for attending. I think this has been fantastic. We really love the fact that you're doing this. Please go out, start your own companies, find someone else who's starting them and offer to help them. There's so many roles that you can play. Be an angel investor. There's so many roles that you can play. And by all of us coming together and doing this, go find some white men who support you, too. That can help as well. That's what's really going to make the difference. So I am looking to all of you to help change the world, and I can't wait to see what you do. Thanks so much.
Thank you.